Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting and video streaming live from our studios in New York City. You can watch today's program by going to Progressive Radio Network Facebook, or you can download it later. We have an interesting program today in that we're going to take a look at things that are happening in clear sight of everyone, yet not being addressed. I'll talk about my one-day visit back to West Virginia and what I observed there, and it surprised me. So I'll talk about that. I'm also going to show you today the front page of yesterday's New York Times and why it's so significant for those of you who have believed that we were not being told the truth. And yesterday, the New York Times actually proved it. So, why is that important? I'll explain that as well. Also today, Conjuring Up the Next Depression, Truth Dig, Chris Hedges special commentary. I'll be having my own adding into that. And we have a guest in the second part of our program today. Professor Nancy MacLean is going to talk about a deep history of the radical rights stealth plan for America, meaning the legacy and activities of the Koch brothers and its future impact. But we're going to go back and see how did the Koch brothers become this power to shape, to mold much of our national conversation. And this is a woman who is one of the leading authorities in the world on that. So you'll understand the Koch brothers and the rights movement and much of the politics behind that. And we also are going to speak briefly about, as temperature rises, the bugs will eat more of our food. Why should that be of concern to you? Well, it definitely is a concern for over 4 billion people worldwide. So we have a lot of information. Now, I just want to mention also that you never know when, through hacking, which has happened in the past, through a station possibly where you're listening right now, no longer choosing to carry the program, one day you tune on and we're not there. But we're always here every day, Monday to Friday, noon to 1, Tuesday at 7 p.m. with the Progressive Commentary. And let me just give you the numbers. It doesn't hurt to have them, because this way you go to any computer, you can go to any telephone, cell phone, and you can listen. Listening live, the number is 424-203-8046. Again, 424-203-8046. And if you miss that and you want to listen on the archive later at your convenience, call 710-719-9976, 710-719-9976. Now, the antidepressive effects of chili pepper are important. This is from the Kaduna State University in Nigeria, and researchers found that the chili pepper, I mean just the regular chili pepper, doesn't have to be super hot, the capsaicin possesses antidepressive properties, which makes it a promising treatment for depression. The study was published in the European Journal of Medical Plants, and it simply asks, can you have a natural antidepressant that can make a difference? And they found out, yes, you can. So the key is the more chili pepper that you consume in normal amounts, let's say you put it on your brown rice, you put it into a sauce, the better it is. Now, we knew that it will lower blood pressure, and it naturally thins the blood. I recommend people take a high heat unit, which is one capsule, 3 times a day, especially before you go to bed at night, because it helps thin the blood, preventing a stroke or heart attack at night. So now we know it helps with depression. Also, people who are mindful or practice meditation feel less pain. In MRI imaging, pinpoints supporting this brain activity. This was from Wake Forest Medical Center. And why? If you meditate, if you focus your energy on being present in the moment, why is it that you can tolerate more pain? And they say it's because mindfulness is related to being aware of the present moment without the emotional reaction or judgment. You're simply accepting it. I remember once I had an operation, and it was for a detached retina. I'd been in a race that morning, and by evening I had a problem. And the problem was a serious problem. This guy is passing, he's a huge guy, about 6'8". His elbow came back and hit me right in the left eye, and it detached my retina. I simply went blind in that eye. I finished the race. It wasn't his fault. I didn't blame him. And so now I have to get this fixed. And the only place I could do it was at this specialist, who was considered the best. I went to him, and he was taking my pulse rate, and he started to give me some drugs. I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "Well, I got to numb the eye. It's about 2.5 hour operation. I got to take the eyeball literally out." I said, "I don't want any anesthesia." And he said, "What?" I said, "I don't want any anesthesia." He said, "Well, I have to give it." I said, "You see my pulse rate? My resting pulse rate's 49 beats per minute. If it goes 5 beats above that, you can give me the anesthesia. But if not, I don't want it." That freaked him out. But that's what I did. I kept it the entire 2.5 hours at 49 beats per minute. And he didn't ask why or how. He simply accepted it. I've done the same thing for, you know, a dental procedure. And people are just unaware that you have that kind of control in you. How do you think you finish an ultra marathon? How do you think you finish an Ironman? By, you have to accept in that moment that that pain is exactly where it's supposed to be. It's not about forgetting the pain, denying the pain, or dismissing it. You simply accept it. Once you accept it, then translate that to anything else in life. If I'm being given bad news that something bad has happened, I can't change it. If someone dies, I can't bring them back. But I can simply accept that that's information. Now, how I choose to respond to it is the key. And that's going to be based upon my conditioning. How have I been conditioned by others to respond in a given moment to a crisis? Some people, taking the message from their family, break down. They go to pieces. And, okay, that's their conditioning. And some people seem to get upset over everything, and even insignificant trivia. They just can't handle things don't go the way they're supposed to, and then their whole argument ensues. Why? Conditioning. What if they simply accepted something for what it is in the moment that it's happening? It doesn't mean it's right or wrong. It doesn't mean that it's good or bad. It simply means it's information. Why can't we hold things at the level of information until we figure out what is the most appropriate response to this? It's appropriate to grieve when you've had loss. It's appropriate to be angry when there's injustice. You can get angry and go out and start cursing in the street and throwing your fist, or you can be more methodical and say, what can I do to focus my anger, which is legitimate and natural, into something that is constructive? How can I build something positive, something that's negative? Well, that's our conditioning and our own free will. So one person will get angry at something, and then they just stay angry all the time. And they're angry at everybody in the environment, and they're like a hypersensitive sore that you touch and they scream. Or you can say, let me protest this. Let me write. Let me do something. Now, this Wednesday, I'm going up to Poughkeepsie, New York, and I'm going up to Kingston, New York, not far from New York, hour and a half or 2 hours. And I'm going to be filming Gerald Salante, one of the brighter minds. And he's bright in a non-assuming way. He's just very open and honest. Never ask Gerald any question that you can't handle his answer, because he doesn't try to disguise or sugarcoat it. But 3 years ago, Gerald Salonte, myself, Mia Benjamin, Ralph Nader, and Dr. Robert Thurman all got together to start a movement called Occupy Peace and Prosperity. What we could do that would create a different model than the existing corporate vulture capitalist model. And so I'm going back to look at Kingston as a microcosm of what doesn't work. And there's rampant drug use, there's rampant, and why? Why? Well, you got to talk with the drug addicts. You have to talk with the people that they're in their families. Why is it you have a house that's built in 1700 that's beautiful and right beside it is a crack house? And beside that's another beautiful house, and beside that's another crack house. Who wants to move into that neighborhood then? Then you go to Poughkeepsie, and it's really in a bad position. But you wouldn't know about the problem unless you go there till you see it. Once you see it, then you can decide what is the most appropriate response. Just being angry, it's not going to change anything. Blaming the politician doesn't change anything. So from your concern can come positive steps that someone can implement. Look, right today, I think it was yesterday, they are taking this huge apparatus out into the Pacific Ocean, and they're going to take it over to the great garbage patch twice the size of Texas, that nothing has been done to help it, diminish it. And this one apparatus could at least get half of all that debris taken out, recycled, and brought back to shore in cubes. And this all came from a 14-year-old boy in Denmark who saw the problem only when he was out there in the water and swimming and saw how he was in the Greek islands, beautiful place, but the water's not beautiful. The people are wonderful. I highly recommend it. The food is great and healthy. Then you got to go in the water and you wonder, I'm taking in all these micro crystals of plastic. They can last forever in my body, do harm. He did something about it. His concern, his anger about the adulteration of nature created a solution that's now being applied. Take a problem, create a solution. Did the government come up with it? They never come up with diddly squat, and we all know that, a bunch of idiots. It was an individual. I am a great believer in the power of the individual doing something. The biggest environmental movement in the world, in India, to help stop the abuse of children working. First, it was young boys working, making bricks, and then young girls weaving. Was a 13-year-old here in the United States, and a 14-year-old here in the United States. More than any government, more than Bill Gates and the other people of his caliber, who could do something because they certainly had the resources and the infrastructure, but they didn't. Because they won't do anything, in my belief, that doesn't profit. But two young, formidable teenagers created the biggest movement that caused laws to change and stopped the working at slave labor in these environments. So we're going to see what we can do to change the ghettoization of America. The state's not doing it. They're doing everything ass backwards. Take New York. Take Buffalo. $1 billion spent, and not a penny goes to help the average person. Boy, these politicians got it wrong. It's fortunate for them that these entitled people don't ever have to live in the real world. In any case, just take that whole, it's all interconnected, what I just said. From being mindful of a problem but not overreacting to it, including pain, to the fact you can't control the outcome of everything in your life. So what is the purpose of being doubly harmed? What you can't control, and then overreacting to it where you're going to be adversely affecting your health. High blood pressure, blood sugar rises, cortisol's released, stress hormones released, because you're walking around in a fit of rage. And instead of being outraged, then go right back to what can I do constructive. Simple. Now we're finding that there is a default mode network that extends from the posterior cingulate cortex to the medial prefrontal cortex of the brain. And these two brain regions continuously feed information back and forth. And this network is associated with processing feelings of self and mind wandering. So that study provided a novel neurobiological information that showed people with higher mindfulness had less activation in the central nodes, the posterior cingulate cortex, of the default network that caused them just to experience less pain. So, what's happening on the exterior world is being manifest in our brain, either ways that are constructive or destructive. So, mindful meditation, prayer, being aware, all can be positive. From a Greek university, Harkopio, the Mediterranean diet and depression in older individuals can make a big difference. So if you are on a Mediterranean diet, which is mainly fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds and grains and tubers, locally grown and fresh produce, and they add fish, that you can help prevent depression because you're feeding the body the very nutrients it needs to help depression not manifest, plus you are stopping diabetes and heart disease, both of which manifest with a regular diet, and from diabetes and heart disease, you end up depressed. So lifestyle makes a big difference. Also, and got to understand, in all these countries, they're also seeing an adherence to the American diet now causing not just obesity and diabetes, but also depression. Good information for those who want to inhibit breast cancer cell proliferation from Fujian University of Traditional Medicine in China, what is called Huang Kui or astragalus, A-S-T-R-A-G-U-L-U-S, astragalus. Now, astragalus is used to help stimulate the immune system. I suggest people take it during when they're, let's say, change of seasons when the body's immune system is not doing that well. It enhances immunity. But this long-used traditional Chinese medicine, with its earliest records of use dating back over 2,000 years ago, a new study published in the British Medical Complementary Journal, a mainstream peer-reviewed journal, showed that astragalus is able to prevent the spread of breast cancer cells in the body. That is important. So add one more thing along to all the others that we have now seen can help with preventing breast cancer, including high levels of vitamin C, quercetin, vitamin D3, all important. And just to give you an idea, astragalus also helps treat the common cold, upper respiratory tract infections. It strengthens the body. It's especially good during periods of immune deficiency. It helps the body avoid white blood cell deficiencies, such as leukopenia, which occur during chemotherapy. So everyone on chemotherapy should be considering this. So it treats skin disorders like burns and carbuncles and hepatitis and chronic colds and cardiovascular conditions. And finally, eating just once a day is associated with a longer life in this study. This is from the National Institute of Aging, as well as the University of Wisconsin. And the article was published in the current issue of Cell Metabolism and reported in the findings of researchers from the National Institute of Aging, University of Wisconsin, Madison, and the Pennington Biomedical Research Center, New Orleans, on a longevity benefit of once-a-day feeding in mice in this case. Quote, the study showed that mice who ate one meal a day and thus had the longest fasting period seemed to have the longer lifespan and better outcomes for common age-related diseases and metabolic disorders. Now, let's go back to the early 1970s when I was a young scientist at the Institute of Applied Biology, and I was curious as to why some of the natural hygienists that I had interviewed were living long lives. Now, I'm in my early 20s, and these people were in their, they were in their 70s and 80s, and they were extremely healthy. And Bernard Jensen, Dr. Bernard Jensen, a wonderful human being, he was, in my opinion, one of the two most important health figures on the West Coast. The other was Bernard Jensen. It was McFadden. In any case, he said that he ate one primary meal a day, and he had liquid juices the rest of the day. And I thought about that. And then I met with a group of vegans who were natural hygienists upstate New York. And even though they were older, they had no diseases. They were very trim, very fit. And that morning, we went on a long walk. Now, I was a marathon runner, and I was exhausted at the end of this walk, and they weren't. That gave me a whole new appreciation for them. So I went into the lab, and I took a group of lab rats, and I don't support vivisection. I'm an anti-vivisectionist, so none of the animals I ever work with were ever destroyed, meaning we didn't kill them and then open up and see what their state of health was. I believe in helping them live as long a life as they could, and they did. I'd even take rats that were used in other experiments downstairs, like radiation experiments where they were burned, heal them, and then have them live a long life. Not in cages either. I didn't believe in cages. They had 3,000 square feet. I put food in different places so they had to find the food. Giving a challenging environment to any form of captive animal is important to keep them searching. I'd play music all day, different types of music, see what they liked, and give them juices fresh made. But what I started to do, I took all the nutrients that would normally be in a standard rat pill, and I would get it all from natural sources. So it was living, enzymes, phytonutrients, antioxidants, and that's what I would give them each day, once a day. So they were on a restricted diet, but they were extremely healthy, and they were happy, and they could run all over the place. And at the end of a year, another group that were cross-matched, equal number, from the same litters were kept downstairs. And those downstairs lived their normal lifespan and died. The ones upstairs on the third floor, no, they were still alive a year and a half later. So I wrote up a paper on modified fasting and living foods. And at the monthly meeting where all 16 department heads met, each of us had a chance, if we had something unique, to make a presentation. So I made a presentation. I asked, could this be sent out for publication? And the answer was no. And the reason they wouldn't publish any of 156 different creative and original and successful experiments I did over the years until I later became a research fellow, and those people died off, is because they didn't believe it. So listen carefully to this. They didn't believe in Gaia. I'm going to do a commentary tomorrow on the Gaia and the person who founded the concept of Gaia. And by the way, it wasn't who we believe it was actually Aristotle. In any case, as interpreted through Plato, I'll discuss that tomorrow. They didn't believe that life was a unifying force, all meant to support the life of each of its elements together, cooperatively and collectively. All a reductionist, all those from the German reductionist field and the Austrian reductionist field dismissed all this as nonsense. And that's where the word or the concept of pseudoscience came from, because anything involving prayer, belief, the hope and faith, miracles, if any of that were ever implied or stated as a part of any model of behavior, it was immediately considered pseudoscience, meaning there's no verification, no validation, no replication. Even when there is, they dismiss it. And they say that only Immanuel Kant would be one of the best examples, who believed in the brain and the mind were one and the body was separate. That don't confuse your thoughts with the power of those thoughts over your body. So everything was reductionist. And so here are all these people who simply didn't believe that that there was any basis for an energy exchange between chlorophyll and phytonutrients and antioxidants and living foods and the music and the freedom to associate with other creatures in a wonderful environment. They didn't believe any of that. They believed it was merely a coincidence. So I did it again, came up with the same results. Again, they didn't believe it. And then for that final challenge, I invited in 50 individuals who claimed that they had the power through, each one was different. Rabbi Abraham Wiseman from Brooklyn, believed it was his faith. Dr. Thomas Kruth of the Order of St. Luke believed it was his faith. Olga Wuerl, her faith. They all believed they had the capacity to help exchange a disease for wellness. And they thought that was utter nonsense. In fact, the director of the institute says, do not tell anyone that you're doing this experiment. I'm going to allow it, but don't tell anyone because we could lose some funding. I said, okay. So for over 2 years, 50 individuals tried with mice that I had borrowed that were only going to live about 22 days. They were genetically engineered. They had ascites tumors. And of those 50 people, five were able to reverse the cancer. So that you can say, okay, that's just a coincidence. That's possible. So we did it again and again and again and again and again and again. We did it six times. So six out of six times, each of those people were able to reverse the disease, terminal disease, to wellness. And you can see photographs of that experiment. And you'll see Rabbi Abraham Wiseman. You'll see myself and some of the other scientists at the institute who wanted to see what was going on. And then you'll see one woman who was head of nursing at New York University, dean of the department, Dolores Krieger. And from that, therapeutic touch evolved. That was the beginning of therapeutic touch, which is now taught in all the nursing schools in America and throughout the world. And we proved a phenomena. The phenomena was that energy can be exchanged. But then I would go much further in that, understanding what is actually being exchanged in the energy. And now I have a whole new concept. In fact, I'm writing a whole new book, a sequel to Living in the Moment, Prescription for the Soul. It's a new one all about the exchange of energy and positive or negative in the intent. And so now that energy can go back. And I went back in, and that was published in the Journal of Psychotronic Research, by the way. They allowed that to be published. The director did, because he was there and saw it. And everybody didn't know what the hell was going on. And he said, the fact that you all can't explain something doesn't mean it's not legitimate. And he said this in the meeting. He says, all of you know that this experiment now was done. I was here. I actually supervised it. He did. He said, I wanted to see with my own eyes something I never believed possible. And I saw it. Now, I don't understand it. It confuses me. But the fact is that legitimate people in their own life, medical doctors, deans of a department, people with good reputations did something that no one else has ever duplicated in a scientific study. It's the first of its kind. And by the way, before Dr. Roy Warford got credit for fasting mice and becoming this international celebrity because of it, I'd done it 5 years before, except mine wasn't allowed to be published because they didn't believe in it. In any case, when I tried to explain that you have two mediums of food. One is a standard rat chow. I did not give any more protein, fats, or carbohydrate than what was in the standard rat chow. But what I gave had energy. That one is denatured. And they could not understand that. Well, you mean if you give sugar in a teaspoon and sugar in an orange, they're the same? No, they're not. Completely different. And then try to tell that to a dietitian. I'm a registered dietitian. Try to explain that. I was actually thrown out of class five times by trying to explain something my professors in dietetic school could not understand. In fact, the last time I was thrown out, the dean said, we've never had any student ever brought to class. You've been brought down here five times. I said, well, do you figure that it's not because I'm arguing? I'm not arguing. It's just that the teachers don't want to have anyone say anything in class that will dispute their position of authority. And that wouldn't matter whether they're teaching dietetics or physics or any other course. They don't want to be challenged. Power doesn't want to be challenged. Authority doesn't want to be challenged. I don't care who it is. So anyhow, I'm going to do more on this whole aspect of energy. But that goes to what they were showing also here, that we can change the outcome of disease based upon the quality, the purity, the energy, the freshness, and the completeness of food compared to what we're doing now. We're taking whole food, fractionalizing it, breaking it down, pasteurizing it, blanderdizing it, stripping away its nutrients, stripping away its antioxidants, stripping away its enzymes, and then refortifying it with a few junk nutrients and say it's the same. It's not the same. And our entire educational system is based upon a lie. The standard American diet is good. It's not. But then again, the standard American diet is no different now than the standard educational system. They are malnourished. Back in a moment with a special commentary. Please stay with us. Nice to have you with us, everyone. We're going to go to our guest in about 10 minutes. And if anyone wants to join us this week, I can only take a couple people because I got a whole crew to go up to Poughkeepsie and to go up past New Paltz and a little past, just a few miles past Woodstock to Kensington, so you can see how I do a film and listen to the interviews. I'll allow two people to come. And if you're a person living in those areas and would like to be interviewed, if you're part of the new poor, if you're part of this whole financial crisis, then by all means let us know. And we'll see about filming you. And also we're going to have one day next week where we're bringing people into our studio here where we have a green screen studio set up where we can film you if you are a victim of financial crisis. We'd like to get stories, the human interest stories, before we go on the road. We got a lot of them out there to film. We'll be down in Mississippi. We'll be down in the bayous. We'll be down in Houston. We're going to be in a lot of places filming a lot of people. Go to prnstudio@gmail.com to give us your story. If you'd like to either join us this Wednesday, starting in the morning, coming back that afternoon, or if you want to be filmed, prnstudio@gmail.com. During the financial crisis of 2008, according to Chris Hedges, the world's central banks, now this includes the Federal Reserve, that you would know I'm opposed to. I believe the Federal Reserve and all of its regional banks should no longer have any power over creating debt and buying, selling, buying, or causing the purchase of bonds. I believe that should all be done by the Treasury Department at zero interest, and I believe all government debt where the government is owed the money, like on student loans, should be forgiven. Now, it could afford to do that. It chooses not to. It's not about economics, it's about political resolve. So what happened was the Federal Reserve injected trillions of dollars. By my estimate, based upon the research I've done, it's $21 trillion, as an example. Citigroup was given $2.3 trillion. Goldman Sachs was given over $800 billion. Zero interest. And they could do what they wanted with that money. And here's a question. Of $21 trillion, did any of that go to stop nearly, and the latest figure is around 7 million homes from being foreclosed on? No. How about giving money to small businesses to keep them open and vital? After all, more Americans work for small businesses than the federal government or state governments combined. The answer is no. was a given to bring factories back into the United States or take existing factories and remodeling them, having them for new usage? No. Was it given to, let's say, help with reforestation, building new roads, fixing dikes and dams and levees, bridges and tunnels? No. No, this fabricated money has created a worldwide debt of $325 trillion. Let me repeat that, $325 trillion. Last week, I gave very specific and accurate figures that we have $200 trillion in debt in the United States against a $20 trillion gross domestic product, which means, and if you were watching Chris Hedges and I 1 hour discussion, and if you didn't get it, you really should. I think it, I was told almost 11,000 people, that's 11,000 downloaded over the weekend to watch. So you can go to PRN, Facebook, no, Progressive Radio Network, Facebook, you download this. And I went through all these figures with Chris. Example, states owe $6 trillion. They can't repay that. Consumers with mortgages, with credit cards, with car loans, with student loans, with businesses. A lot of these businesses are up their eyeballs in debt. So when you look at the debt to gross domestic product, it's almost 1,000%, meaning we are 1,000% in debt compared to our gross domestic product. That makes us worse than Italy, Spain, Greece. And that's more than three times the entire global gross domestic product, which means the entire world is bankrupt. The fabricated money was hoarded by banks and corporations, loaned by banks at predatory interest rates, used to service interest on unpayable debt, or spent buying back stock, providing millions in compensation for the elites. And the fabricated money was not invested in real economy issues. Products were not manufactured and sold. Workers were not reinstated into the middle class with sustainable incomes and benefits and pensions. Infrastructure projects were not undertaken. The fabricated money reinflated massive financial bubbles built on debt and papered over a fatally diseased financial system destined for collapse. What will trigger the next crash? The $13.2 trillion in unsustainable U.S. household debt, the $1.5 trillion in unsustainable student debt, the billions Wall Street has invested in fracking industry that has spent over $280 billion more than it generated from its operations? Who knows? What is certain is that a global financial crisis, one that will dwarf the meltdown of 2008, is inevitable. And this time, with interest rates near zero, the elites have no escape plan. The financial structure will disintegrate. The global economy will go into a death spiral. The rage of a betrayed and impoverished population will, I fear, further empower right-wing demagogues who promise vengeance on the global elites and moral renewal and a nativist revival heralding a return to a mythical golden age when immigrants and women and people of color knew their place in a Christianized fascism. I hope that doesn't occur, but we are so close to it occurring. The 2008 financial crisis, as the economist Naomi Prinz points out, converted central banks into a new class of power brokers. They looted national treasuries, amassed trillions of wealth to become politically and economically omnipotent. She wrote a book called Collusion, How Central Bankers Rigged the World. And she writes that central bankers and the world's largest financial institutions fraudulently manipulate global markets and use fabricated, well, fake money to inflate asset bubbles for short-term profits as they drive up towards a dangerous financial precipice. And we're there now. Do you really believe that the asset-backed Wall Street numbers are real? They're not. Do you believe that any of the financial numbers you hear coming out are real? Do you believe we really have a 3.8% unemployment rate when half of all Americans can't live without a paycheck for 2 weeks? Do you really believe that we're that successful that we don't have to look at 16.8 million hungry children, 2.5 million Americans living on $2 a day? Do you really believe that when you go from city to city, almost every major city has massive unemployment, massive amounts of poverty, neighborhoods gone under? Tomorrow I'll talk about that from my own hometown. We've been lied to. Our real unemployment rate is closer to 22 to 26%. And yet we're in denial of this. We're in denial of anything that gives us the truth. Instead, we're massively deregulating and putting predators in positions of power at all the major governmental agencies. The Federal Reserve handed over an estimated $29 trillion of this fabricated money to American banks. That's according to researchers at University of Missouri. $29 trillion. Let that sink in for a moment. We could have provided free college tuition to every student or universal health care, repaired our entire crumbling infrastructure, transitioned to clean energy, forgiven student debt, raised wages, bailed out underwater homeowners, formed public banks to invest at low interest rates in our communities, provided a guaranteed minimum income for everyone, and organized a massive jobs program for unemployed and underemployed. 16 million children are going to go to bed tonight hungry. And there's 553,742 Americans who are homeless every night that are counted. They're not counting the other millions who are staying with friends but don't have a quality of life. These are the things that we should be concerned about, and unfortunately, we are not. I'm Gary Null. That's just a reminder that we should pay attention. We're going to go to our guest now, who is standing by, so she can give us a better understanding of how we evolved to a place where our concern about each other, our concern about our environment, our concern about having a government that works for us with our input is more important than lobbying firms that control the entire process and front groups and think tanks and foundations by the elite that are there to make sure that we have Citizens United that can allow them to control the political process. Everything else is simply a cheap kabuki imitation. Let's say hello to Professor Nancy MacLean. She is the William Chafe Professor of History and Public Policy at Duke University, where she specializes in race, gender, and labor history and 20th century social movements. And in the past, she was the chairwoman for the Department of History at Northwestern University. She is a fellow of the Society of American Historians and received many awards for her publications, especially on the history of the Ku Klux Klan and the American women movement and segregation and human rights activism. And her most recent book is Democracy in Chains, History and the Radical Right's Stealth Plan for America, which is a piercing examination into the history and background of right-wing academics in the tradition of the Nobel Laureate James Buchanan and of Charles Koch, of the Koch brothers and their campaign to eliminate unions and suppress voting and privatize public education and stop action on climate change and make a radical revisionist effort at the Constitution. So she's here now. Let's say hello to her. Nice to have you with us today.
It's great to be with you, Gary. Thanks for having me on.
After reviewing your in-depth research, one of the important take-home messages for me is that the Koch brothers, notably Charles Koch, and his efforts to hijack the nation is not a new phenomenon, nor a fluke in American history. This is a legacy that goes back to the early 19th century with John Calhoun, a South Carolina statesman who served as vice president in the late 1820s, who strongly defended slavery and promoted the concept of minority rights of white Southerners to run the government. And in some respects, we can trace the origins of what we think of as the Libertarian Party's platform back to Calhoun and this legacy of a wealthy elite that believes it stands at the pinnacle of human evolution and therefore it's best qualified to run the country. And it's done so in many ways since the economics of James Buchanan and now Charles Koch have had the power to do this. So first, I feel it's best to explain Buchanan and Koch's vision of democratic governance and what are the salient features that define this libertarian vision. The forum is yours.
Yeah, well, it was very interesting to me in doing this research because I felt like I was entering a whole alternative universe, one that I didn't know, and it's actually one that we wouldn't even have to pay attention to if we were in a fair world with a functioning democracy. And, you know, in your setup to the interview, you were talking about how the power of money and rigged rules have really transformed our system of government at this point, such that people like those in the Koch network and the hundreds of operations it funds can have outsized influence. So these libertarian ideas are not popular with the public. Routinely, they never poll, you know, they usually poll between 2-4%, and that's not even people who are kind of actively committed to or promoting them. But as interpreted by the Koch network of organizations and the academics that it works with, they essentially are committed to what I have come to think about as property supremacy, you know, a notion that the rights of property of corporations and of the wealthiest among us should be able to trump what we, sorry for that, would trump what we are able to do together as a people, even super majorities of us. So they want to essentially be able to act as a veto power on the people in our system of government. And it was fascinating to me after researching this one particular little-known economist, but a Nobel Prize-winning economist, James McGill Buchanan, whose ideas the Koch network has weaponized to transform our country. It was fascinating to me that Buchanan's own colleagues at George Mason University said that the school of thought that he developed had the same intense and impact, or I'm forgetting the exact words just now, but as John C. Calhoun's property supremacy of the early 19th century that Calhoun used to justify slavery and reinterpret our Constitution. So here we are in the 21st century with this libertarian billionaire-backed right advancing a system of ideas that is very much like one of our leading slaveholders. And, you know, I think people here have to remember that that wasn't just about race. That was the most profitable system of capitalism in the world at the time in the early 19th century. And people like John C. Calhoun were well aware that majorities were frowning on slavery in the rest of the country. They didn't want people to be enslaved. They didn't want the way this system distorted the whole society and the political system. So they were organizing against it. And so Calhoun wanted to stop that with his interpretation of the Constitution. And Buchanan's own colleagues at George Mason University actually wrote an article in which they said that John C. Calhoun was a precursor to this guy, their colleague, James McGill Buchanan, whose ideas the Koch network is essentially weaponizing in order to reverse engineer the 20th century to bring back this kind of property rights utopia of the kind that existed in the Gilded Age.
Thank you. I appreciate that. The grand intellect behind the Koch brothers has been a Nobel Prize laureate in economics, James Buchanan. I believe he died about 5 years ago. He was the main inspiration for Charles Koch, and who I might add is not simply a clueless entrepreneur, as he's been projected on the left. He's actually a very astute scholar in revolutionary change, notably Lenin, whose strategy he adopts in his playbook, and the Austrian School of Economics, and the anti-Keynesian Friedrich Hayek and von Mises, which is like putting the free market on steroids to create a democracy and support the pursuit of what he considers pure liberty. Would you address that?
Yeah, so I would say Buchanan wasn't Koch's inspiration, because Charles Koch has been at this since the 1960s. His inspirations were actually Friedrich Hayek, whom you mentioned, and Ludwig von Mises, these people that others think of as market fundamentalists, who really were peddling ideas that actually have been tried now in many states in America, and they're failing terribly. You know, you see them in Oklahoma, you see them, you know, in Kansas, where they have, you know, practice harsh austerity policies, slashed public education budgets, privatized, et cetera, and people are now rebelling against the impact of that, even Republican elected officials. So his original inspirations were these Austrian economists, as they're called, you know, these kind of imported thinkers from Central Europe. But what Buchanan gave him that these other thinkers didn't was a strategy, a technology, as Koch calls it, in order to effect a change that he knows, as Buchanan did, is not popular. Most people do not want to live in the kind of world that this cause would bring into being, so they have to figure out a way to surmount that. And it was Buchanan's ideas that enabled Koch to surmount that huge obstacle of the unpopularity of this vision. And he did so by emphasizing to figures on the right and to other libertarian thinkers that they should stop focusing on the question of who rules, you know, which individuals, even which parties, and start thinking about the rules. And if they didn't like the outcomes of public policy over a long period of time, and libertarians don't like essentially everything that, you know, since the emancipation of the enslaved after the Civil War, almost all the major reforms are opposed by them. And so what Buchanan did, though, was to emphasize not focusing on who rules, but on the rules and changing the rules. And so that's what we've seen happen with such a vengeance, particularly since 2010 and the 2010 midterms, when so few Democrats turned out to vote, and there was this Republican Red Map project, as it was called, to get control of the census and the redistricting process so that a minority power could push through radical changes in state after state, including my own North Carolina. So following Buchanan's notion of changing the rules, what they have done is things like the most radical gerrymander in our history in order to let this minority Republican Party rule in a way that we can't, like in North Carolina, we can't get rid of them because the way they have drawn the political lines makes it very hard to get them out of office. So they're choosing their voters rather than voters choosing their elected officials. They have also instituted the most radical voter suppression measures, you know, the likes of which we haven't seen since the White South destroyed black political power at the turn of the 20th century. They have also pushed for crushing public sector labor unions, denying workers the right to have that collective voice. And we've seen that, you know, beginning, of course, in Scott Walker's Wisconsin in 2011. But, you know, in states around the country where they have power, they are attacking public sector unions. And they've also, the Koch Network's allied operations, have promoted the litigation to undermine the power of public sector labor unions that just scored such a huge victory with the Janus case. Another element of how they push this agenda that I call a stealth plan is by consciously spreading misinformation. So, for example, they spread misinformation about the climate to pretend that there is no consensus among scientists on climate change and the urgency of doing something about it. And they also spread misinformation in the form of this myth of voter suppression, I mean voter fraud, the myth of mass voter fraud, in order to justify their voter suppression measures. So those are just a few examples of how the Koch network has applied Buchanan's ideas to get what they otherwise could not, because they understand that they are a permanent minority, that if people knew what they were actually seeking, for example, a world with no Social Security or Medicare, no federally guaranteed workers' rights, no public education, and on and on and on, people would shocked, and they would organize and they would resist that. So this network is instead going around the margins, trying to do things without calling attention to them and without being honest with people about why they're doing what they're doing.
We only have time for one last question, but
okay.
When you look at one of their main objectives is to privatize everything, We have seen both the Clinton and Obama factions within government and many of the corporate Democrats supporting privatization. And so at what point do we start to take an honest look at all the both of the major political parties and realize that they will tell you something to get elected or stay into power, but then you actually see what they support, and they're not so dissimilar on many of these issues?
Yeah, that's absolutely an issue. Now, I don't think that Democrats would go as far as Republicans. I mean, I know they wouldn't. There's no Democrats who are trying to suppress the vote or things like that. But you do have, and you have in New York right now, you know, with Governor Andrew Cuomo, a governor who has lashed out at public sector labor unions, who has pushed a lot of the kind of neoliberal agenda, as you're talking about, that undermines the power of the people, and that hold on one sec, that undermines the power of the people, and that also enables, you know, systemic corruption, enables corporate control, enables kind of Wall Street power to skew results. So definitely, I think that in order to deal with this threat that we're facing, we need to hold Democrats accountable as well as Republicans to a wide-ranging kind of must-have democracy reform agenda. And I think, you know, your upcoming primaries are an example of an opportunity, really, to kind of send a message that the system needs to be reformed, and people are very serious about that.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate you coming on and sharing this with us. My guest, Professor Nancy MacLean, MacLean, author of Democracy in Change, History of the Radical Right's Stealth Plan for America. Appreciate you being on with us.
Good to be with you. Thank you, Gary.
We're out of time, everyone. Thank you all for listening. And tomorrow I'll deal with four major articles in the New York Times that support what we've been saying for years, and this is the first time they've actually acknowledged it, and three of those four stories were on their front page. So the question is, if we got it right years ago, and they're just getting it right today, wow, how much authority then does the paper of record have? Have a nice day, everyone.
Hit it.
How you feel, brother?
Feeling good.
You feel good?
Feeling good.
Play so much bone, brother. How you feel, man?
I feel all right.
I call your name. I don't want no people to know you're in here.
Yeah.
How you feel, brother?
Right.
Hey, jam. Yeah. Sure getting down. Look at him. Ah. We're gonna have a bunk. Take them up, Fred.